Hi, I'm Brett, if you don't know me. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about. Not working. Okay, I'm going to be talking about the layers of our program. Chrome is like an onion or a parfait, where there's many layers that go deeper and deeper. An onion parfait. So first, I'm going to show you how to get to the information that I'm going to tell you, so you can look it up later when you aren't watching the talk. So this is the Chromium developer site on dev.chromium.org. And what you do is you first click on for developers because you're a developer. And the things I'm going to be discussing are under the engineering design docs here at the bottom. So if you go to the engineering design docs, these first two things are probably the most important. So there's the multiprocess architecture, which Darren talked about. And here it's got an overview of everything. If you're confused about what Darren said, this is a good place to start. The other thing to look at is how Chromium displays web pages, which is what I'm going to be talking about today. So it's got a discussion of everything you have and diagrams and stuff like that. So this is one of the diagrams from that page that I'm going to be discussing a lot. So Dimitri just talked about WebKit, which is at the bottom. That's kind of our low-level library that we use for rendering web pages. As he said, that lives on webkit.org. And if we change it, you have to change it on WebKit, and then we pull it to our tree. So historically, we also had a WebKit port. And the WebKit port provides integration with the graphics layer, like Skia, system fonts, the network. And we've got our own implementation of all those things. That's called our port. And we've recently moved our WebKit port into the WebKit tree. So that means anytime you need to change something with fonts or graphics, you're going to have to also make a patch to WebKit, even though it really only affects us right now. So these two things both live on WebKit, and they cannot depend on any other parts of Chrome. Because they live in WebKit's tree, they should be able to compile by themselves. So the next layer is the WebKit glue, which we have in our WebKit directory /glue. And that kind of provides a wrapper around WebKit that we use to access it. And so it does several things. It provides type independence. So WebKit uses its own string types, its own URL types. It has lots of dependencies all over the place. And we don't want to have Chrome inherit all that stuff, because we're going to be confused with, you know, 10 different string types and, you know, two URL classes. So the WebKit glue's job is to translate types between, for example, a GURL and a KURL, or a web core string to a standard string. And so it kind of provides all the an implementation of all the interfaces that WebKit uses. So there might be a frame loader client callback thing. It will implement its own, convert it to Google types, and then it will have its own callback interface that you'll have to implement. So there's kind of a hop as you go across this boundary. And so if you do need to get something, if you're in our WebKit port and you need to get something from the browser, like the browser process or something higher level, you actually have to go through this delegate interface that hops through to the WebKit glue, and then that's implemented at a higher level. So the WebKit glue shouldn't depend on any other parts of Chrome. It's basically our embedding layer, so you should be able to write a new browser using our WebKit glue, totally different in every way. And we have such a browser called Test Shell, which is a separate browser that's just uses our WebKit glue. It has its own simple front end, and that's it. So Test Shell can't depend on any other parts of Chrome other than base. So here's our directory. So base here at the top is kind of used by everything except the web core code, which obviously isn't ours. So WebKit glue depends on this. We've got our network library that depends on this. You know, we've got our sandbox that depends on this. But basically nothing else here except Chrome depends on anything but base. So for example, net doesn't depend on you know, media or IPC or gears or Chrome. And then Chrome kind of brings all these things together into the final product. So hopefully this makes it easy for projects to pick up our different components from these top level directories. They just have to take base and the sandbox or whatever. So, so WebKit glue depends on base, and that's it. So you can write a new browser that's single process, or you can use our multi-process embedding layer, which is, as Darren talked about, it's got the render process, And okay, let me talk about that. so the render process is kind of implemented in this this renderer project, which is in Chrome/renderer. So these are things like render view and render widget. They're called render. Everything starts with render. And that talks to the corresponding interfaces on the browser side. So each interface in render has a host in the render host directory called render view host or render widget host. So these two things kind of go together. They're both sides of the pipe. And if you want to write a multi-process browser, you use this renderer host layer, which is in Chrome browser renderer host. And just like with Glue, it shouldn't depend on other parts of Chrome. So it shouldn't know anything about our browser or the fact that we have tabs or anything like that. And if you want to write a multi-process browser, you should be able to grab this layer and you're, you know, ready to go writing everything else different. So we aren't perfect in this respect. Sometimes it has some bad dependencies, but please don't add more. So one way to think about this is, you know, say you're writing a dialog box that has a web page in it, but it looks kind of like a dialog box. You should be able to embed this renderer host, like a render view host, in that and just kind of get a web page. It shouldn't have all these things like a password manager or history or anything like that. So if you're wondering where to put stuff, if you need it in a dialog box or something very simple like that, put it there. If it depends on other parts of Chrome, put it in a higher level. So the renderer host has a delegate interface, which is how it talks to the higher levels. So that's implemented by our tab contents layer. And that's kind of the layer that really integrates with the rest of the browser services. So for example, it talks to history, it talks to you know, the password manager, the navigation list for back forward, and all this stuff. So tab contents kind of brings everything together. And above tab contents is the browser window. So you shouldn't ever be talking up directly. So tab contents has a tab contents delegate that browser window implements. And in fact, other parts of our system actually use tab contents that aren't the browser window. So you shouldn't ever depend on you know, being in a browser window. So you talk up through your delegate to talk to the browser window. The browser window has the tab strip, manages tab switching, stuff like that. So obviously it's easy to talk down. The browser window can talk to any of its tabs. The tab contents can talk to the renderer host. These talk to Glue, and Glue talks to WebKit. And one of the things we have on the buildbot is this check depths, which is not here. It was on the old build. How do I get to the old build? Does anybody know? Oh, the old buildbot? Okay, anyway. So there's one step of the build that says check depths.
It's like waterfall.
So this check depths tries to enforce that you don't include files from other parts of the project that you're not supposed to. So let's see. Okay, so here, one of the first steps on the main buildbot, it updates and then it runs this check depths program. So if you ever see check depths go red, that means that your change, you know, for example, included something that it wasn't supposed to, like made a dependency from the network library to Chrome. So if this ever goes red, you need to back out your change or fix it really fast, not just make it so that inclusion doesn't break the build, because that is telling you that you're not supposed to do that. To try to kind of keep us honest. And it's got a, if you have any questions, you can ask me about that. It's got files in each directory that kind of show, files in this directory are allowed to include base and net, but nothing else. So there's kind of a set of hierarchical rules that it uses. And that's my whole talk. Anybody have any questions?
How does Darren's rewritten Chromium port affect all this stuff?
I don't know. Peter's asking how Darren's rewritten Chromium port in WebKit affects this. I think it will go kind of in between Glue and WebKit. It's kind of, it will be using WebKit types, so we'll still need a Glue layer to convert types. But it will be a more stable API because right now WebKit Glue kind of talks to these crazy WebKit classes that change every day and causes us problems. But I haven't seen it.
Is it feasible someday to pull out like the renderer host into source slash renderer host or something above Chrome if it's supposed to be kind of like a usable embedding layer?
Peter asked if we could pull renderer host out of the Chrome browser directory. Maybe we haven't had a need for that. But it would be nice if we were able to and it had like no dependencies. But it does. Yeah, I can't think of any reason why it should be impossible.
Then you could rename WebKit Glue to be like, you know, single process embedding layer or something, and then this one could be multi-process embedding layer.
Okay. Peter has some crazy naming ideas.
Thank you.
Any other questions?